All right, very great. When one is given information, the next thing to do is to pass it along, and that's what I'm doing here. I was given a tremendous amount of information yesterday, and I'm sort of unwrapping it and processing it and starting to see, you know, the clarity of it and what's going on, and it's just it's so intense. I have to say that, for the best of my understanding, the period of September 11th, 9/11, 2/15 to 9/22, September 22nd, is the actual period of conception of the New World Order. There are events will take place that will symbolize the conception of the New World Order. And then from September 22nd to June 22nd, this is the 9 months gestation, at which point it will go through the labor pains and be born in July, let's say, you know, mid-July, something like that. And the New World Order will be fully here, fully birthed at that time. So coming back to where we are right now, 7 days before 9/11, the double jubilee of 9/11, 14 years after, apparently there's going to be two events. I talked about this extraordinary situation in the video yesterday. I talked about the extraordinary situation that took place on a golf course of all places, and I was miraculously guided to be right there, and this fire broke out in like a combat zone with like warplanes flying us over, and it seemed like, you know, a battle zone. And I just remembered that it was on the back nine, so in the 11th hole, the back nine, 11th hole is where the fire broke out, 9/11. Okay. Now, I was told that it was symbolized that someone had been working out for 3 weeks. They planned to have a 3-week workout, and their new job would start in 3 weeks. A new job, meaning this is the New World Order is like a new job. It's the artificial intelligence civilization cycle. Fourth dimension, if you want. There's this 3-week period starting in like the 1st of September, starting on September 1st, I would say, 3 weeks of preparation for the essential. When we say, when does life begin? Well, it begins at conception, many say. And so the conception phase will end September 22nd. So September 1st plus 3 weeks is 21 days would be September 22nd. This is what I told someone was symbolizing this to me there, and he said, I'm going to be working out for 3 weeks, and then when the new job starts, and he was into information technology. So this new world order of information technology, the conception phase will end September 22nd, and I would say that the period between September 11th and September 22nd, which would be 11 days, will be this conception phase, and the preparation, 3-week preparation for it, is to get yourself in shape, get yourself ready for it, if you want to go in that direction, which we certainly don't. So I'm just saying, this is what is taking place now. And then the 9-month gestation brings us exactly to June 22nd, which I said, by June 22nd, 2016, we will have to be confirmed in our refuge status, being able to take refuge from this, because that's truly the birth of a new world order, and it will be here in its entirety, just like a child when it's born, it's here in the world. Okay. So what I was shown there on the golf course, in 9/11, there's going to be some sort of outbreak of something very intense. I was also told August 29th that to get ready for September, you must begin to have good habits and detach from reaction, the agents of reactivity, which is the media and the news, and to detach from this. So, and also I did a video, do not react in September until October. Whatever happens in September, simply don't react to it. So now I'm starting to get more information about, you know, what could happen in September. It could be very, very intense, actually. Not critically intense, necessarily. Not critically intense. I don't know about September 23rd. 9/11 may not be critically intense, but it may be something very reactive, very fast-burning, very reactive. And this will lead the conception period of the New World Order up to September 22nd, which, by the way, just happens to be when the Pope is coming to meet the President of the United States, the two most powerful people in the world. The crucial leaders of the New World Order, actually, are meeting in America sometime around 22nd, 23rd, which is the Jewish Day of Atonement. You know, this is extraordinary what is happening in September here. And I've been tipped off about September. And so, what is the answer to all this? The answer is right spiritual practice. And the Holy Spirit just told me, hey, you're really, really good at this. So look at it that way. You have a skill, have a great value in this. And so the right thing to do is to help people who want to orient towards right spiritual practice, meaning not reacting to what's taking place in the world. That's the whole thing. About this morning I was doing spiritual practice. I got very, very deep, very, very deep into inquiry. The peace of God. I said, the peace of God is here right now. It was very, very much in the right focus this morning. Now, when you wake up and move around and do stuff, you know, some clouds come, but that's okay. That's what happens. However, so close that, you know, the timing could be perfect here to help people with spiritual practice and to align with those who are really central to this whole plan of right spiritual practice during this time. Right spiritual practice doesn't mean praying to God, saying, God, please, I want to be wealthy. God, please, I want to have a good house. God, please. That's not right spiritual practice. Not at all. Right spiritual practice is affirming truth, the truth of what we truly are, and that there is nothing whatsoever that is changing the nature of God, which is shining everywhere but remaining as nothing. Shining as everything, remaining as nothing, as no thing. Shining as everything and remaining as no thing. Pure potentiality, absolute peacefulness, absolute stillness, absolute non-preferentiality. This is the peace of God. So our practices have to do with affirming, reassuring, affirming the truth of our being, and getting away from reactivity. There's no reactivity in God whatsoever, none. This is the peace of mind that passeth understanding. So right, knowing what right practice is very, very, very crucial to this whole situation that we're going into right now. So there have been those who have been trained in right practice, and I'm one of those who are here to help out. Now, it may seem a little ragged at this point, but I'm not so worried. I've done the practice. I've gone through it, just like golf. I know that I get out on the course. Oh, okay. I haven't hit a shot in 2 years, hardly. Maybe hardly any. Get out there, an extremely difficult tee shot, and hit it absolutely perfect for right off the bat. So, if you know how to do right spiritual practice, and I've done a lot of that. When the time comes to help out and do it, I'm sure that I'll be able to do it without any difficulty. What we don't want to do is try to do both react and do right spiritual practice. This is what the Holy Spirit told me. He says, you got to make a choice. Time to make a choice. Which way are you going to go? I said, okay, no problem. We'll do the spiritual practice way. This is the way. And I cold turkey just stopped the news. I said, okay, that's it. It's go time. So we cannot be reacting to what's taking place in the world and at the same time practicing that there is no cause for reaction at all. Obviously, these two things are mutually exclusive. Because if you're reacting, you're believing in reactions. If you're practicing no reaction, you're believing in no reaction. There's nothing to react to. Nothing is happening at all, actually, from the standpoint of God. everything is just continuing on perfectly as it always has. Appearances arising, God shining as all these appearances, and yet remaining as no appearance whatsoever. Shining as all appearances, yet remaining as no appearance whatsoever. This is the nature of God. This is our nature too. Nothing is changing that at all. Excuse me, I just got up in this morning and I have to get this information out. There's no question. Now, the person that was helping me with this information here, he said he was going to play 36 holes on Labor Day. 3-36, 3-6 is 6-6-6. Labor Day. Okay, this has to do with kicking off this cycle, isn't, doesn't it? What is Labor Day? 9, yeah, that's Monday. And it's going to be very, very hot. Very hot. We're in a heat wave. Well, heat wave is coming here. And he said, it's going to be difficult, but I'm going to try to do it. 3-6 is, no, it's going to be really difficult, but I'm going to try to do it. What is that? Laboring for mortal mind. Trying to spiritualize mortal mind. It's going to be really hot. It's going to be really difficult. I got to get started. I got to try to do this. Okay, the whole thing was mortal mind telling me what's mortal mind going to be doing. So we have, this world is the expression of our belief in mortal mind, spirit's expression, our pretension. So it is going to go through this period of trying to bring about another cycle of spiritualizing mortal mind, which we call the fourth dimension. The fourth dimension is an attempt to spiritualize mortal mind. It's this—it's the highest sophistication of that, using artificial intelligence. And this is what the New World Order is all about. What we're about is the realization there's no such thing as mortal mind. Okay, so there's extraordinary divergence right now taking place. Extraordinary divergence. And this is what is difficult to, as this divergence is taking place, it can get a little rocky. And this is where it's important to take refuge during this time of divergence, which will be essentially 9 months and how far are we now from this is the 6th, 22nd, 18, 9 months, 18 days, something like that. But we're really into it. But let's just say this basic gestation period, conception gestation period before the birth, is going to be a divergence now of the ways. Very rocky time. We want to take refuge. I believe we will have help in taking refuge. I really believe that. Meaning those who want to do right spiritual practice, which is to realize we've never been born. Spirit cannot be born. We've never died. We've never been mortal mind. We've never been a mortal existence. There is no mortal existence. It doesn't exist. It's a fantasy. It's wishful thinking on our part, actually. But if we go the path of trying to spiritualize mortal mind, call it whatever you want, the egoic path, the goddess path, this is when we'll get hooked into the fourth dimensional artificial intelligence, roboticism, and the hellishness of that. It was an extraordinary situation yesterday, and this man that helped me with this, who was bringing this all to my attention, thanks to the Holy Spirit for that, was someone who worked out 3 hours a day, but on heavy, you know, weights, making the body physically stronger, working out physically. And I said, well, that's going to mess up your golf game. He said, yeah, it does, because you have to be really flexible and fluid there. So physicality is going to mess up your spirituality. If you work out physically, get physically stronger, and don't do spiritual practice, this is going to tighten you up, constrict you, and it'll just be more, you'll lose your finesse, you'll lose your spiritual articulateness, which is what happens in this. As you have seen, as this fourth dimensional situation of cosmic corporate culture and artificial intelligence is coming to this world, what has happened to the world? Everybody has started working out physically, haven't they? I mean, in the 50s and 60s, Nobody worked out. Almost nobody worked. I mean, gyms didn't exist. Few people, health nuts, method barbells or something, but nobody. No. Especially women. They didn't work out like that. They weren't into physicality like that. Look at it now. They're absolutely obsessed with this. Everyone is, but women especially are obsessed with physicality. We have boutique gyms opening up like mushrooms here. Everywhere you look, there's a new boutique gym. Who's going to the gyms? Women are. Who's running the gyms? Women are. They're obsessed with working out and physicality. And so are the men. This has come about when the information technology, IT culture came into this world, this takeover of the world. These people are obsessed with working out, running marathons, going to the gym, physicality. Whereas the real workout is to do 3 hours of spiritual practice every day, and maybe six, but 3 hours a day is about right of spiritual intent, spiritual prayer, like, you know, God, this is really my intention. Please accept my intentions to awaken from the dream of mortality. Please accept my intentions. And then that's prayer. And then affirmation is, yes, I already know that I'm already awake. Yes, I will. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I'm already awake. I'm already awakened. I am eternal life. I am absolutely eternal life. You know, this is assertions. And then the fourth phase is to say, yes, I know that I'm already eternal life and already not eternal life, which brings about abidance in eternal life, because this way it cancels out the continuity fear. It cancels it out by honoring it. You see, we have to honor our creativity. So instead of taking an absolute idealized position, we take this position of it's both. And this honors our creativity, and this enables us to abide, even here in this world, enables us to abide in the eternal mind. Vision of oneness. Seeing God. Vision of God, really. Shining as everything, remaining as no thing. So right spiritual practice is the workout we need to be doing. And otherwise, it's becoming very clear what your destiny, how your destiny will unfold. It'll go into this artificial intelligence, fourth dimensionality, antichrist, egoic, which is really the voice of continuity fear. You see, when you're working out physically, you're not doing anything with your continuity fear at all. You're just trying to spiritualize it, actually. Spiritualize the belief in mortality. Make it strong. Make it beautiful, you know. And so, nothing is happening in your continuity fear. You're making it worse, actually. Not dealing with it at all, which is the ego's, that's the ego's path. Just don't deal with the continuity fear. Because the ego is just playing a waiting game. Okay, this has to be very much stressed. The ego is playing a waiting game. It's waiting for pretense to convince spirit. And spirit believes it's made this imaginary God to judge its imaginary death and say, indeed, you know, imaginary death requires an imaginary God to judge it, that it's indeed dead. And then from this deadness, spirit believes it will be resurrected as the new prime creator. So ego is just playing this waiting game, trying to keep this, you know, waiting for the judgment. Ego's always waiting for the judgment, the final judgment, saying, yes, you are indeed, you attained death, true death. And so it just delays. And the continuity fear is the great wall, the barrier that keeps us delaying. And it's funny, at the golf course yesterday, I hit a shot, I hooked it so hard into this huge stone wall, and it, wham, you heard it hit, but we didn't know where it went. And my playing partner said, oh, when we got down there, he said, oh, it looks like it's lost, I can't see it anywhere, you know, you're lost. And I said, you know, whatever, I thought it, you know, should be here somewhere. And then suddenly he said, wait a minute, is that a ball down there, you know? And he thought my ball was his, And so he thought I was lost. But then he saw his ball down further, and my ball is perfectly in the middle, you know. So in hitting the wall, the continuity fear, I was able to work evaporated, and I'm not lost at all. I'm right in the center, exactly where I need to be. The ego's plan is to ignore the continuity fear and say it doesn't exist. That's the ego's plan. Why? That keeps us waiting. Because as soon as we try to move towards eternal mind, we run and hit this wall. And say, whoa, I can't, what is that? And then you go back to waiting again. I'm trying to spiritualize mortality. So it keeps you waiting. Trying to spiritualize mortality helps you wait. Because you think, well, it seems kind of spiritual here, you know, we're all kind of doing little spiritual stuff. And so I think I'll keep waiting. I'm not going to tackle that fear. It seems too much for me. And so, okay, I'll just pretend it doesn't exist. Keeps us waiting. So the ego's entire strategy is to keep us waiting, which is to ignore the continuity fear, do not work on evaporating it. But then we're just stuck. Wait, and just wait. And what happens? Nothing happens. We just keep waiting. There's no outcome to waiting at all. There's no final judgment that we have indeed died to what we are. Never happens. Will never happen. So we just continue waiting and continue working on, you know, trying to stay occupied and distracted, and which is the fourth dimension. The fourth dimension is just a dream of distraction, of more sophisticated distraction, where you're measuring the cosmos now, taking, you know, trying to understand all the energy of the cosmos and working on that, the astrological patterns of all the planets and all the forces at play in the universe and all the biodiversity and, you know, measuring, studying, scientific, mathematically working, spiritualizing, trying to spiritualize it, make your working on your bodies, you know, testing yourself, having monitors on you to write minerals, trace minerals, trying to make your body like perfectly healthy, you know, and trying to be happy with mortality. All this stuff, this is the ego. This is the Antichrist. Okay, plain and simple. Couldn't be more cut and dried. The option is to wake up from the dream and see God and realize nothing's ever happened to God. No impact has ever been made on God. No impression has ever been made on pure potentiality. And yet God is still shining as everything, but remaining as no thing. And realizing that the realization is very, very deep, profound and deep, that I've never been a body. I've never been a body. In fact, bodies aren't even bodies. I've never been in a world. Worlds aren't even worlds. It's all just a dream, all a pretending. It's all a pretending. The pretender is never what the pretender is pretending to be. You see, this is very important. The one who's doing the pretending never becomes what it's pretending to be. It was never that. We're just pretending to be all this, but we've never become this at all. Not even the tiniest bit have we ever become anything that we're pretending. We've never become a body. We've never become time, space, process, or form. Never. And in this meditation this morning, I became very clear about time and space, process and form, how there's no such thing at all. These don't exist. It's complete pretense. So right spiritual practice does lead us to the true awakening. That's the right path. It's amazing, this active meditation that was happening. I sort of had a semi-dream where I'm going toward this bench, and there's someone sitting there on the bench. And I went to sit on the bench, and there was this pile of doo-doo, you know, right there where I was going to sit. And I call it doo-doo, because doing, actually symbolized doing. I said, I can't sit here, so I have to go sit next to this person on the left. And then suddenly I said, oh, wait a minute, wait. There is this area on the right, extreme right of the bench, not a lot of space, but just enough space to sit down, so I'm not sitting in the doo-doo. I could sit there. I said, wait a minute, let me sit there. On the extreme right-mindedness. See, we are so used to taking the attempt to spiritualize mortality, the pretense mortality, the dream of death, trying to spiritualize it. We think that that is spiritual practice. It's not at all. It's the Antichrist. It's the ego. It's a continuity fear. And so we think, well, we don't want to go extreme in our practice. See, from the standpoint of the ego, it sees right spiritual practice as extreme because it thinks it's doing spiritual practice. It's not. It's doing the waiting game by trying to siphon off our desire to do right spiritual practice by saying, well, that's a little extreme, but you can try this instead. You know, this will work better, even better for you. Well, it works better for delay, but it doesn't work better for awakening at all. So sitting on this extreme right-mindedness is right spiritual practice. This is what we need to do. We don't need to go in the do-do. Do of the world, of the fourth dimension, mean delay, 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 distract, 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 do anything but right spiritual practice. The characteristic of this world is people do whatever it takes to avoid right spiritual practice. Whatever it takes. So they're frantically doing. Why? As an excuse. As an excuse. Now, I saw this morning that the body, all needs are projected upon the body. The body doesn't even need to breathe. It doesn't need to eat, doesn't need to breathe, doesn't need to do anything, actually. It's all projected upon the body. But everything we're projecting upon the body as needs are not, it's not true at all. Just the same way in a dream, having dreams of needs, are those real needs? No, they're not. So all this doing, we're constantly, well, I got to take care of the body, I got to do this, I got to do this, I got to do this, do... This is designed to prevent us from an excuse. We have an excuse so we don't do right spiritual practice. And if you canvass the entire world right now, you would find extremely little right spiritual practice taking place anywhere on this planet. And yet everybody is frantically busy, aren't they? Frantically busy. It's this frantic busyness which is an excuse that we're using to not practice spiritually, because our continuity fear is saying, no, if I wake up, I won't have any function. It's kind of like if you fall asleep and been dreaming for a long time, let's say, and then you're afraid to wake up, say, well, I wake up, I won't be dreaming anymore, and dreaming is my function. I can't stop dreaming, it's my function. This is the fear we have, that pretending, or dreaming, pretending, is our function. And this is the drastic problem that we have, that we believe dreaming is our function, pretending is our function. If we stop, we won't have any more functionality. We'll be annihilated. This is called the continuity fear. And even though we kind of feel like, you know, that might not quite be right, it's like this void. We feel that this terrible... How do we make a smooth transition, you know, into what's right without this void? And this is why this practice of I'm both enlightened and not enlightened is very important. It smooths out this continuity fear for us. It smooths out the fear of abidance. It smooths out the fear of abidance in God, where we no longer have any need to dream or pretend. So we intentionally dream and pretend in a very mild way. Say, well, yes, I'm both enlightened and not enlightened. Obviously saying I'm not enlightened is a pretending dreaming, but it's just sort of a symbolic token. It's a token dream to honor our creativity. And this then enables us to then abide in God while we're still here, in the realization of God. And I was very much close to that this morning in the meditation, contemplation, inquiry. Very much just sort of easing into it and seeing, okay, so I'm right there. I say I'm absolutely right there and absolutely not right there. So those who are able to practice in this way, this is a very strong indication that you're very close to abidance, very close, because this is the practice that you use that eases you into abidance, which would mean continuous awareness of the presence of God, continuous awareness of the presence of God. And in this abidance, then, Or will you relax your mind and release your thoughts and let them go, realizing those are all just a play of imaginary play of reactivity? You don't need any of that. Once that happens, then the peace, you're suffused with this, the presence of peace is with you. You're abiding in it, and there's a whole atmosphere of peace about you. And as Ramana Maharshi said, the atmosphere or presence of peace around a saint is the only sure indication that there is a saint here. That is the sure indication. It's not all the words or concepts or talk. It's the feeling. You can feel the presence of peace suffusing the area of a saint. There's no question about it. And he says, this is the sure indication. It's the only real indication that there's actually a saint present. And this comes when we relax our mind, release our thoughts, and let them go. They serve no purpose at all. Now, I've been having this very much core release of suddenly there'll be a ripple, like of agitation, ripple through the core of my being, so to speak, and just dissipate. And I might even tremble a little bit or shake a little bit, and it's like, this is happening. I mentioned I had this rapid vibration at the base of my skull several times about a week ago. I said, what in the world is that? I felt like some intense release of conflict or agitation or reactivity. So the reactivity, which is completely unnecessary, it's false, imaginary, made-up evidence that God is reacting to all this appearancing that we're pretending, this all mortality, the supposed impermanence, which is really, it's not really that at all. It's just a rising, sustaining, and subsiding of just appearance, which has no effect on all the non-appearancing at all. It has no effect on pure potentiality. It's all, in that way, it's all the same. So we can, so I feel that this is all this is being released somehow in a subtle way. It's like, wow, very subtle, but it's there. Sort of be like a quivering in your core, something like that, which and it seems to just then be gone. So it's sort of a letting go of the contraction, all the contraction of reactivity. When in the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, vision of God, there is no there's no reactivity of God taking place to whatever's appearing. Anything and everything can appear without God having, there's no reactivity at all. There's this absolute stillness, perfect peace and stillness, which Ramana Maharshi was in that visionary state all the time, showing us this no matter what's taking place, God is absolutely still, absolutely peaceful, absolutely blissful, calm. A sheer seamless tranquility that is endless and no traceless. No reactivity at all. Not even the faintest residue of trace of any reactivity there. And we can actually experience this while we're even here in this world. In fact, for example, Ramana Maharshi said, you must be enlightened while you're still in this world. This is where you must do it. This is where you must do it. So, getting back to pragmatic practice, will there be right spiritual practice? I say yes, yes. I feel I would be able to do it to a certain degree, absolutely. In all different modalities, you know, very flexible about it. We're not hung up on any anything in particular. You know, you can practice this way, you can practice that way, you can practice this way. What's important is that we're practicing. Some people like to practice by repeating, it's called japa in Hinduism, japa. You know, you say Ramana, 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 Ram. Very powerful practice. Some would say it's the most powerful practice, but I don't know. Sankirtan, you do call and response. Someone says, Ramana, 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 Ram. And then the people practicing respond, Ramana, 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 Ram. So it's practicing non-reactivity to the world. At the same time, affirming eternal mind. Ram, Ramana would be just a term for eternal mind. We call it, Western people call it Jesus, we call it Christ. Different traditions. What's important is you're simply expressing your intention. That's what's important. The label doesn't matter. It's the intention. Ultimately, words have no meaning. They're all symbols. So there's no meaning, real meaning, or real self-existent to words at all, meaning labels, symbols. So it's only important to reverberate your intention. Because keep in mind, God doesn't react to anything. So the idea that you can say some words that get God to react is totally false. What we're doing is we're bringing to mind, with Ramana, eternal mind, the presence of God, means no reaction. So all this magic about symbols and words and magic, we just say this, you know, this comes from the Vedas. Ultimately, this has to be transcended entirely. Because appearancing is not reacting. It's just our desire for the appearancing to arise. At the same time, concurrently, God is not reacting at all. So it's not a reaction of God, what we're experiencing. We keep thinking this is all a reaction of God. It is not. It is the Son, the Spirit, Son of God, that is desiring experiencing as appearancing, as feeling, etc., which arises, but in the desiring, the arising, the experiencing, and the letting go of that experiencing. All of that, as that's taking place, the pure potentiality of God is not reacting in the slightest bit, in any way. So we have this, a September to remember, for sure. Surfing September is how I'll put it. And the way to do it, I would say, is whatever happens in September, you just say, well, I'll evaluate it in October. Right now, I'm coming to a decision of which way I'm going to go. Because once the conception of the New World Order is officially takes place, which I believe the Pope coming to America at that time, is the official, I suppose he's going to meet the president, the POTUS, mortician in chief. And this meeting is the official, you know, symbol, external symbol we would have that the New World Order has been conceived. Now it has been truly conceived. And then 9 months from that point will be the birth where it's actually, we'll say it's actually, it is now fully here. And fully activated, right? When the child is born, it's now truly active. So we are not going to react to that. We're not going to react to whatever happens 9/11. We're not going to react to what happens September 22nd and 23rd. Interesting. Yeah, hopefully the world does not get hit by any asteroids. However, I would say that the Pope and the President represent two asteroids or space rocks. The idea of condensed, being dark, condensed, fourth dimensional, path of delay, Antichrist, ego, fear. And their coming together could represent as if there's severe impact upon our belief system, a double impact upon our belief system. There's going to be a double impact. There's no question about that. The Holy Spirit is pointing this out very clearly. When those walnuts I was taping and fell right directly above my head with a huge whack and rolled off, I looked and I saw it was two walnuts, double walnuts. Everything that I've seen is a double impact, okay? However, it not necessarily space rocks, okay? It could be, but it may be that the real space rocks are the Pope and the President. Those are the two space rocks. That their impact upon the psyche, the belief system of this world, is more, you know, could be more powerful than two space rocks. Actually, that would just bring about, you know, a physical catastrophe. But what they're bringing about is a spiritual catastrophe, or a belief system catastrophe, you might call it. Of as the POTUS, the MOTUS, you call him, mortician in chief, the MOTUS, said that, oh, you know, the Pope and I, we think alike. We think alike. I can't wait to meet the Pope. We think alike. Yeah, the Antichrists think alike. Of course they do. And so he's saying, wow, this meeting is going to be historic. It's very important. It's going to have a huge impact. The idea is that September 22nd is going to be an unprecedented impact upon this planet from the point standpoint of belief. Okay? So, you know, space rocks impacting would impact us. Oh, gosh, how am I going to get food? How am I going to survive? But it wouldn't necessarily impact our beliefs that much. Whereas this meeting between the Pope and the President is likely having an extreme, profound impact on the belief of this planet. And I believe they're going to agree upon a general direction for the world. They're going to agree on the ideational structure of the future of this planet. They're going to say, yes, okay, we're on the same page. We're going in the same direction. This is, you know, what we're going to focus on. You know, climate change, blah, blah, blah. You know, all sorts of stuff. All sorts of stuff. That basically, you know, humanity, mortal existence, humanism, secular humanism, this is the focus. This is the path. This is what's going to happen September 22nd, 23rd, when the Pope is here. Maybe he's here for 2 or 3 days. Right at the day of a Jewish Day of Atonement. It is quite extraordinary, the timing of all this. It's not any mistake either. So that may be the double impact. And this man telling me he's going to play two rounds. You know, double impact. Double impact. There's no question the double impact is coming. I'm convinced of this. Will it be space rocks or the Pope and the President is the actual double impact? Now, I have not had a dream of space rocks hitting yet. You know, I have not. So I would suppose it's the Pope and the President that's the real double impact here. And the whole asteroid thing is kind of just a symbol symbolizing it. Or, you know, both might happen. But I would say, you know, the real impact is the Pope and the President meeting. And it may be that on September 11th there may be some pre-arranged conflict or something will happen. All, you know, this is all arranged beforehand on purpose to, in order to enhance the President and the Pope meeting, in order to get the world's attention on them, as this is a super important meeting because we have this really, really tense situation going on, really drastic. It's very scary. And here the two people that can save the world are meeting. And so it's some way of getting the attention on them. Okay. Well, they're attention whores. There's no doubt about it. And they will have set this up ahead of time. The overall egoic plan. You know, they're part of this egoic plan of what? Delay. Don't recognize the continuity fear. And as I've said before in many videos, the way the ego is accomplishing this right now, which is to avoid our continuity fear, is to put women in charge behind the scenes Of course, the Pope is a confirmed Virgin Mary worshiper, Mother Mary worshiper, which is really pagan, egoic, antichrist religion of trying to spiritualize the flesh. And the POTUS, the MOTUS, is controlled by women. You know, he didn't have a father, basically. maybe he thinks he had an immaculate birth. You know, probably does believe that his father conceived him and then left. You know, so maybe he thinks he's immaculately conceived also. I wouldn't doubt it. That in his mind, that's what he believes. And he's raised by women, and surrounded by women, and is in key positions, appointees, United Nations appointee. Let me see. There's so many. I can't even go over all of them. Attorney General, Supreme Court nominees, his inner staff, closest staff women. All these are women, and you know, there's many, many, many more. He takes advice. He takes advice from. And so, the thing about the ego has told women that they don't have a continuity fear, or that they're so superior, spiritually superior to men, that they at any instant they can just let go of the continuity fear. So they don't even have to focus on it. In fact, the ego tells them to focus on it is to demean yourself. And men are trying to, the ego says that men are trying to deceive you by all the spiritual practice they've been doing and effort, refusing to recognize your true greatness, that you don't have to do that. This is what the ego told women. You don't have to do this because you're greater than men. Only they have to do it. They're the ones who are stuck with the ego. You're not stuck with continuity fear. You know, so the whole idea is that the spiritual practice that men, mostly men, but some wise women too, for sure, a lot actually throughout history, have been doing, realizing they have this severe continuity problem. The ego, again, wants to lead us away from that, say, no, don't practice on it at all. So it has convinced these radical feminists that to even suggest that they need to do any spiritual practice is an insult, is sexism. This is what's guiding the president and the Pope, that it's sexism. The Pope is very much a feminist, a radical feminist, actually. Both the Pope and the President are radical feminists. They're completely have bought into this ideology and promoting it. And the Pope is talking about how sexist men are. You know, it's just revolting what the Pope has been saying. You know, he's just a naked antichrist, actually. Black Pope, the last Pope. We know this. This is the last Pope. He's the Black Pope bringing about the destruction of the Church. Ideological destruction of it. Last President, too, actually. And it may very well be that they have planned for some sort of global catastrophe, global problem, and in order to then create a new world order, which means they'll come to an agreement. I think they're going to come to an agreement eventually. Well, the Pope will say, "I'll agree that there'll be no more Pope if you agree that there'll be no more President, and we'll combine the tradition of a religious authority and the tradition of secular authority, because the president's the head of the global tradition of democratic secular authority, and the Pope's the head of religious authority, you know, numerically, at least, right? We'll combine those two, and we'll say we'll have a new authority. We'll have a new authority. And this is the New World Order, which is no more sovereignty. It's a global bureaucracy now. This is their plan. There isn't any question about it. This is their plan. The modus in chief always saw the presidency as just a stepping stone. He wants to be the dictator of the world, actually, and sees himself in that role. Probably a reincarnation of Akhenaten, the Egyptian pharaoh, or a cloning of Egyptian pharaoh, DNA cloning of Egyptian pharaoh, the modus of the U.S. And so he sees himself. I should rule over the whole world. I should be the world ruler. And the Pope feels similar, that, you know, he wants to have all power too. So the Jesuit, they want to have all power over. They want to rule the New World Order. They're the ones who have been helping set the whole structure for the New World Order, the Jesuits, actually. They're into mortal mind, okay? They're into mortal mind. And This is the first Jesuit Pope ever. And he's acting exactly like a Jesuit would act. So they will agree. There's already some agreement between them, actually. And now they're going to use this next 9 months as a way. Once they meet, then the next 9 months will be to lay out, you know, and begin to tell everybody, hey, you know, this is what we decided to do because the world is just in too bad of a shape. They're using global warming as an excuse. Now, many people realize this. They're using global warming as an excuse. If you look about through the history of the planet, the changes in the climate of the planet are just extraordinary. The planet's constantly changing. You know, CO2 levels have risen really high in the past, gone down much lower in the past. There's all sorts of volatility in the history. And they're just saying, you know, that, okay, global warming is, you know, we have to do, the Pope says basically, we have to do radical changes immediately. And they're saying, if we don't do that, we're all going to perish. You know, no, that's nonsense. But this is what they're trying to sell. This global warming is the key thing. The Pope and the President have latched onto this and say this is the biggest issue in the world, and they're going to use that as the excuse to take over all power, but by this agreement that they have, to take over and destroy all sovereignty, all rights, all civil rights, all rights will be gone. And they'll say, well, we have to in order to combat this global warming, because if we don't, we'll all be annihilated very soon. You know, they say, hottest year on record. Well, how long have they been keeping records? Not very long. You know, there's all sorts of fluctuation. If you just go look, study climatology, the history of climatology, unbelievable amount of fluctuation in the world. And animals have survived. There have been extinction level stuff, but life goes on and it makes changes, you know. And we're not going to surrender our spiritual sovereignty to the Pope and the President. That's not going to happen. Not in the slightest bit. And the great teachers such as Jesus, the great saviors, let's call them saviors, so that's what they are. Jesus Christ is one. Ramana Maharshi is another. Longchenpa is another. And there are others too. They're coming back to help us so we will not be deceived by this great deception. Now, is there some man-made global warming? Well, sure. There's some, absolutely. But is this a reason to surrender our sovereignty? Not at all. Not at all. But it seems like it. Ultimately, this world is just our dream. If we want to get the climate the way we want spiritually, all we have to do is write spiritual practice, realizing I'm eternal life itself. I'm in complete control. We're actually in complete control of all our experiencing. 100%. Nothing is happening to us. This is the right way. They're going about in the total wrong direction, and they're using this as an excuse. They actually manufactured this excuse. The Green Revolution manufactured this excuse for us. We wouldn't even be talking about it. But the population explosion was designed to use up resources and produce this situation, which then they can use as an excuse. So it's a very tricky excuse. And I know people are absolutely, they're hooked on that severely. Otherwise, very intelligent people are just thinking that, well, they basically, here's, I'm telling you what the mindset is their mindset is, we will agree to any and all recommendations that the experts give us in terms of to avoid global warming, which the French foreign minister said, climate chaos, you know, to avoid climate chaos. They said, we'll agree to any and all stipulations, recommendations, whatever they are. Just tell us what they are. They will surrender their civil rights. They'll surrender their freedom. They will surrender everything they need. They feel they're told to surrender. They will become slaves of a bureaucratic, technocratic dictatorship, a control society where everything has to be regulated and monitored to, you know, avoid some sort of disaster happening to us. Keep in mind, we're eternal life. We are God. How can any disaster happen to us? It's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. And yet we're so deluded by our continuity fear, we're willing to believe any and all lies because we're afraid of losing our pretending, as if we have no function, so we keep on pretending. So we're pretending that there's climate issues. Sure, we're pretending it. It's all a pretense, 100%. And this is what, you know, people are all confused about. However, the bottom line is this and other issues, terrorism, climate change, all sorts of stuff, they'll say, look, we got so many issues and the world, the way we've been governing ourselves doesn't work. Look what's happened. It's not effective. This is what the POTUS, the MOTUS, and the Pope believe in, that the governance we have doesn't work. It's disastrous. It's causing the planet. It's going to be destroyed. Therefore, we have to find a way to break the habit of self, being self-governing. And we have to put ourselves under this umbrella of one world governance. And they're the ones who are going to agree to that. They're going to have some accord. No question about it. It's already, this has already been, this is the blueprint. It's already there. I don't know if this pine cone, what it represents. It's interesting. Could it be reptilian presence here? It kind of looks like a reptilian skin or something. Is it spiritual vision that I rescued from the garbage, you know, garbage dump, so to speak, or rescued it from being thrown out? Does it represent the pineal gland? You know, possible? We'll see. It's something significant. But at any rate, September, this is the month. This is what's happening. The Pope and the President meeting is the double impact. At the most profound level, there could be some other, you know, it could be asteroid impacting also. That's possible. Or maybe they'll even act, maybe that'll happen September 11th. I don't know. And then the Pope and the President getting together saying, hey, we have to now take emergency global martial law. Has to be implemented, and this may cause Russia to say no, and world war start or something, which is what the Bible basically says. Revelation will be like World War III breakout. I don't know exactly, possible. But again, we're not going to react to what happens on September 11th. We're not going to react to what happens September 22nd, 23rd. The Pope and the President. We're not going to pay any attention to it whatsoever. Actually. And we'll reevaluate things in October in terms of world events. What we're going to do is we're going to be continuing to do right spiritual practice and getting ourselves ready for that, for this 9-month period where the New World Order is in this process of gestation as they iron out the resistance to it. And then by June 22nd, 2016, the resistance will have been ironed out to such an extent that we will probably have this, you know, one world bureaucracy in fundamentally accepted by the world. I mean, that there are all sorts of stuff to be worked out, but once there's this fundamental agreement, and I believe the Pope and the President will make this fundamental agreement September 22nd, 23rd, it's a fait accompli. It's a fait accompli. Remember, there's already been an agreement with the United Nations to give the President, the POTUS, this worldwide power to come up with a structure to prevent the terrorists from moving about, money and movement and restrictions, worldwide restrictions. The President, they actually put the President in charge of this. The POTUS is in charge and given a mandate with all the countries of the world, except I think four, signing on this United Nations declaration or agreement to structure, they'll have a global structure, an agreement, of restricting the movement within everywhere within the world of people labeled as quote unquote, you know, terrorists or sympathetic to terrorists. But I'll tell you this, anybody who does not sign on to the belief that we must make radical changes to combat climate change will be called a terrorist, a global terrorist, not a jihadist, but a climate terrorist. Okay? And that was the real purpose of this agreement. Was to say that there's now global authority, headlined by the POTUS, And the Pope will agree with this. There's going to be this agreement that they'll work together on this to combat climate change. They will agree that there's going to be this overall ideology that anybody who disagrees with climate change, who doesn't agree to severe giving up personal rights, giving up sovereignty, giving up civil rights, they'll be labeled as terrorists, climate terrorists, global climate terrorists. Their movement will be restricted. Their money will be restricted. They'll basically be prisoners. Very interesting stuff, huh? I don't have any doubt about it. This is where it's going now. There's no question this is where it's going. This is how seriously, you know, they take, but this is the pretext. The pretext for control is just being used as a pretext for, you know, one world governance, dictatorship, control, society, which is the reptilians are behind this, actually. Cosmic corporate culture is behind all of this. They want to make this world their slave state so they can rule this world as their little, you know, another little part of their fiefdom, their empire, as it were. Which is the empire of delay, right? Of refusing to focus on the continuity fear. So it's like a hedonistic, you know, scientific hedonistic drug place where, you know, it was where the excuses to avoid right spiritual practice are very, very intense. So the reptilians love that. They love it. Say, I can come here and just really be distracted. That's great. That's exactly what I need. You know, that's what they want. So all of this is coming to pass now. How are we doing? It's been recording? Yeah, great. Very, very great. Intense stuff. Now, now you might say, well, this information is not getting out to many people. You don't have somebody. Well, that's not the big issue. The big issue is, will there be right spiritual practice in this world? Because everybody who decides to turn away from the ego and go with the Holy Spirit will need to be engaging in right spiritual practice, and they'll need to have those who can help them with that. So at some point, you know, there's going to be an open-mindedness to this, and people say, hey, okay, is there anybody here, you know, who's really skillful and can help me with this? And at that point, then, you know, help will be available. That's what's really important. Right now, people are like in this, you know, sort of this, like trying to sort it out. Do I really have to choose one way or the other? You know, they're thinking, yes, you do. You do. Because, again, if you don't go all in with this New World Agenda, if you don't go all in with this, you're going to be labeled a terrorist. No question about it. And you will be imprisoned. You will. That's why they're trying to get rid of cash as fast as possible. Very important. They want to collapse fiat currency. There may be a stock market, global stock market crash. And in order to collapse fiat currency and go into digital currency entirely, and in order then to make it impossible for those who do not agree with the loss of their, you know, surrendering their freedom or turning it over, you know, to control, to make it impossible for them to function here. Right? You can't buy or sell anything unless you have Mark of the Beast. So they're going super fast towards that. No cash can be accepted anymore. And you cannot travel. You cannot travel. Certainly by airplane, you cannot travel. And you won't be able to travel out of state. You know, they put tracking devices on all vehicles. This is, you know, GPS is built in. GPS are tracking devices. Most cars can now be tracked, actually. And so you will be like pretty much under house arrest. And also not even be able to even buy groceries. I mean, it got more and more severe. It'll be a gradual tightening of the noose is what will happen. If you don't agree to surrender your, you know, and give your control of your life up to the global dictatorship. But this is the September meeting between the Pope and the President is the formal conception of the New World Order and the September 11th, whatever, how that ties into it, is going to heighten it, so to speak, heighten the focus upon it. And then 9 months from then, I believe that there's going to be this draconian set of restrictions upon the world. The people will accept it. Not only accept it, will embrace it. When the Pope and the President get him, say, look, this is what we need to do. We've agreed on a very strict path that we need to take, and let's everybody embrace it. I guarantee you that most of the world will embrace it and say, great, let's get into this. Let's totally get into this and save the world. So you won't have, you know, the situation where they have to force it upon everybody. Most people will like leap into it and say, I'm a hero. I'm saving the world. I'm a world savior. I'm saving the world. Remember, it's not the world that needs to be saved. It's we that need to be saved from the world. So they have it backwards. And we're saved from the world by realizing there's never been a world. That's salvation. You know, we think that God's reacting to this world. God's not reacting to anything. So, from a spiritual standpoint, our whole belief that there's a world, that there's a universe, is the belief that this is how we get God to react, as it were. You know, to our death. God's not reacting to our death because we haven't died. If God reacted to anything, it wouldn't be God anymore. So we're trying to get God to react to our death. Say, look, God, there's a whole universe of death. We've died. Spirit, your son has died. You know, no, God's not reacting at all to it. It's just appearances. That's all it is. We're putting all the meaning upon it, thinking that God has to react to this. So I know this is kind of fuzzy. People don't quite understand. But some level, you must say, oh, yeah, I know this is right, but I just need to focus on it and practice it. I haven't been able to do this, which is true. We have not been able to do this very well because the distractions are so intense here. So again, to reiterate, the POTUS and the Pontiff. All right, those are the two P's, right? And, that triggers something that... the POTUS and the Pontiff getting together. Agreeing upon a course of action for the future, which is the egoic path. They're both extraordinarily egoic. Humanitarians, I think they're great humanitarians, you know. Jesus was not a humanitarian. Jesus was eternal life, saying, those who believe in me shall have eternal life. Let the dead bury the dead. He was no humanitarian. He said, let the dead bury the dead. Meaning, let those who are pretending to be dead deal with the problems of pretending to be dead. Those who follow me, he says, your path is that of eternal life. He's very clear about it. And yet they've made a, you know, mockery of it by saying that Jesus was just some great humanitarian and his whole purpose was to spiritualize the planet, spiritualize mortal existence. This is nonsense, absolute nonsense. And Jesus has reiterated this by A Course in Miracles, pointing there's nothing humanitarian about that. It's all about changing your perception and recognizing there's only eternal life, changing your perception of the world, where you can still nominally say it's a world, okay, but you realize it's really not a world. It's just, it's all is God. That's, everything is God. That's all there is. It's just God. You can say, well, there both is and isn't a world. This is how we express it. Well, there both is and isn't a world, and we're fine with that. There's no problem at all with that. There both is and isn't a world. It's pragmatic. It's honoring our creativity. Nothing wrong with that. Holy Spirit says, yeah, that's the way to go. So there both is and isn't a world. And this is our profession, that there both is and isn't a world. This is the profession of abidance in the presence of God here. I asked that one that, after I asked for help, Longchampa showed up. I didn't know who it was, but I asked him, was the water hot or cold? And he said, well, the water was both hot and cold. And then I knew right then that this is someone who's abiding in truth. Pragmatic. So here was someone who understood the pragmatism of our situation. There's a spiritual recognition. I said, great. Here's someone who can help us. So There both is and isn't a world. There both is and isn't a world. And so you know that you can practice what you have an advocate here that will say, absolutely, practice this way. And this is completely right and just to say this as an expression of our basic expression of our faith. Well, there both is and isn't a world. There both absolutely is and isn't a world. So we're able to function here and help others pragmatically, at the same time being aware that there's only God, actually. There's only God. All appearances are the same in that way, that they don't cause any reaction in God whatsoever. All arising, all sustaining, and all subsiding are all the same in relation to God. It's all just God. So very strong video here. We're at 1:10. Let's see if I can do any more or not. We can do a cool down phase here, which is very helpful. If you've heard this, you know you deserve a cool down phase. It's very intense. This is quiet, but it's not surprising. At one level, to hear it is shocking, but at another level, we say, "Oh, of course, I knew this." I mean, there's so many of you out there, of us, who know all this. You know, they know this. This is what's going to take place. What they're not so clear about is what to do about it, which is right spiritual practice. That's the area that I'm clear about. And there'll be those even clearer than I am, like a Ramana Maharshi, for instance. You know, there are those, Longchenpa, Jesus Christ, they're clear about this, you know. They're totally clear about it. Let's put this, there's no lack of clarity in them whatsoever. And I don't put myself there at all, but I'm more clear than not, so to speak. That, you know, the preponderance is towards clarity here, which is all that Jesus said. That's all you really need. See, we tip the tipping point. Where's the tipping point? Tipping point for me is towards clarity. So that's why I was able to stop watching the news so easily. I was starting to get really into it, and I just said, okay, go time, tip right in, you know, to just drop it like that. Others might say, well, yeah, okay, I need to do it. I need to taper off. I need to, you know, but they, you know, they can't just go cold turkey. You know, they're still, tipping point is still towards, you know, the ego, still towards the ego a little bit. So just keep moving that tipping point. Keep moving it towards the Holy Spirit. Heat wave, supposed to heat up. Today is very cool still. We're having this marvelous early fall weather. Some people are just enjoying it to an extraordinary extent. And then tomorrow we're supposed to jump, and it's supposed to start jump. We're supposed to have a heat wave where it's going to be in the mid 90s to upper 90s for like 9 straight days. That's a heat wave, isn't it? When it's like last 9 days, and it's going to be very, very toasty. Nothing extraordinarily hot. You know, maybe reach 100 one day. So it's not extraordinary hot, but just it's going to be, you know, it's going to heat up. Interesting how that's happening here, and then the whole situation in the world is going to heat up. So just sort of casually we can say that it's possible that 9/11, the double jubilees every 7 years in Jewish history, where all debts were forgiven every 7 years. Very good, actually. And there was a grand jubilee, I think 50 years or some huge jubilee, but which was not a 7-year interval, but anyway, double jubilee, 14 years. So maybe it's likely, I would say, but you know, there's something intense will happen on September 11th. I don't know what. It doesn't have to be external combat. It could be ideational. Something very intense can happen then. This is a intentional fire, so to speak, to get everybody's attention. Nothing gets people's attention more than a fire, right? So there's going to be some kind of fire, whether it's external or internal, something to get people fired up, really fired up. Okay, it may be just that gets us really fired up. This is designed then, 11 days after that, the Pope and the President are going to meet, maybe 11 or 12, I don't know, but sometime in their 22nd, 23rd, 24th, right in that period, Pope and the President are I believe they're going to meet. He's going to be here in the United States. So first the fire starts. What happens when this fire starts? Everybody comes running from all around. You know how it happens. Fire trucks are there. They hear the sirens and smoke. Everybody comes out of the house. Oh my gosh, where is it? What's happening? What's happening? Nothing draws attention like a fire. Nothing. It's like, so somehow the world will be fired up on September 11th. It's going to get the attention of the world. Very, very heightened. Okay. And then 11 days later, the Pope and the President will meet. All eyes of the world will be upon them. They are going to have some sort of fundamental agreement and accord that says we are going to work together. We have decided to work together on this climate change, terrorism, whatever the whole, you know, what's it, you know. And we've decided we have to take drastic action on this. The Pope's already said we need to take drastic action. He's convening some big conference from people all over the world, and the Pope says we have to come up with a very strict plan, and we have to implement this throughout the world. Well, I mean, basically, it's dictatorship, right? The rule of democracy is going to be, well, we crashed. The POTUS has already said that he doesn't need Congress anymore because they just obstruct, and he has to move faster. So he's just been just issuing executive orders illegally. So, you know, we'll just call this, you know, an accord. Doesn't have to. A lot of stuff. He says, well, it's too slow. Climate change is going so fast. We're in a complete crisis. We must suspend democracy all over the planet, and we must have experts dictate to us. This is how we're going to proceed from here on forward. This is their mindset. I guarantee you this is their mindset. The Pope and the President. They want absolute power. They want absolute bureaucratic control. So they are going to fundamentally say, this is our future. Put blinders on, folks. You know, everyone is going to have blinders put on them. And this is why it's important to not pay attention to what's happening in September. You don't want those blinders on. Because, as I said, Jesus Christ is already back. I know there are those who think that Jesus Christ is going to come out and reveal himself any day. And that's very possible. But what I say, he's already back. But he just basically announced, I'm back, and gave us an opportunity to process this, and at some point he may very well come out into the open in some way, you know. So he already came back May 1st, 2015, but he may start becoming known to some in the world in a more external way as possible any day, along with others. I mentioned Ramana Maharshi, along Jempa, and there's some others. They may very well come to our attention in a much stronger way than previously. In other words, they're saying, don't put the blinders on. This will lead you directly down into hell, the fourth dimensional hell of delay. What is hell? Delay. Delay. Being stuck in fear is hell. Delaying in fear is hell. And when they put these blinders on, this is exactly where they're taking you. They're leading you down into hell. The hell of delay, of severe delay, thinking that I'm a hero, I'm a savior, I'm refusing to look at my continuity problem, I'm refusing to practice, I'm a hero. This is the belief system. We must, you know, don't recognize the continuity fear. Refuse. And of course, it's very important to have the women on board with this, otherwise it wouldn't happen. So they've given these women very strong leadership positions in the world now, and will continue to. And these women are saying, we don't have a continuity problem. Whatever we want, we get. We're not bound by any such nonsense. You know, those who are weak. You know, they're spiritually weak. This is not true. Actually, to have a severe continuity problem just shows how spiritually strong you are, meaning that you've gone such tremendously creative pretense that has actually generated this continuity problem that you have. You're afraid if you stop pretending, you won't exist. That's not a sign of spiritual weakness at all. And fact is, they do have a severe continuity problem. In fact, it's so severe, you know, they just feel like they'll never be able to deal with it. So they feel they just have to ignore it and hope it goes away, or ignore it. They think that becoming new prime creator, they'll be able then just to decree, okay, continuity problem. There isn't any continuity problem. That's what they're hoping for. And of course, this will never happen that way. So they're Pied Pipers leading you down into the pit of hell. Okay, the whole group, the radical feminists, the Pope, the Pontiff and the POTUS, and the New World Order Illuminati people, all these people are Pied Pipers leading us down, trying to lead us down into hell, which is delaying and fear, and refusing to do right spiritual practice, which evaporates the continuity problem for us. It evaporates it. And I have done this, and I can testify it does evaporate. By doing right spiritual practice, the continuity problem gradually evaporates to the point where your fear of abiding in the presence of God becomes negligible. I have a negligible fear now, you know, very negligible. Whereas before, I had this extreme wall of fear, which came from identifying with mortal mind. This is what mortal mind wants here, and I experienced this. I said, wow, can this be overcome? They said it can't be overcome. You know, they told me mortal mind was screaming out, saying, we're trapped, we can't get free, we're trapped. And I said, that's nonsense, what are you talking about, you're trapped. So I said, okay, let me see if they're really trapped. So I took on the fear of mortal mind and to see if it's possible to get free. Then it is. It's right spiritual practice evaporates the continuity fear. So instead of dwelling in the higher realms of the afterlife, I came back to the world because I thought that maybe they are stuck. You know, I was tricked. You know, not tricked anymore. But they said, no, help, we're stuck. We can't get free. You know, so that was probably. But now that I know what the real situation is, I realize that they're just waiting, playing a waiting game. And they're ignorant about the continuity fear by so doing. So by introducing the continuity fear issue here, I've seeded this in this world in such a way that I know for sure that nobody's trapped. I know for sure nobody's trapped. And I get the whole picture now of what's really going on. So I'll be able to function in a way where I don't get tricked into coming into a world anymore. I don't get tricked into it. Can stay clear of that. And work in the subtle level, subtle ways, which actually I've heard is more effective, actually. Or if you return to the planet, you return as a Jivan Mukti, or you know, avatar or some avatara, savior, where you're never hooked into the belief that anyone's trapped at all. You know that this right spiritual practice will evaporate your continuity fear, and you realize you were never born, you were never mortal at all. This is a fact. No one's ever been mortal. So how can anyone be trapped? The only feeling of being trapped is a continuity fear. And it's the ego that advises of avoiding looking at that. And it wants to put a structure in place of those who can aggrandize into egomaniacs thinking like, well, we don't have a continuity fear just because we say so. You know, we're superior, inherently superior. And this is what the radical feminists, they got hooked into this self-aggrandizement, thinking that you can be, you know, in charge and people will worship you. Because you'll tell them, you don't have a continuity fear. The ego says, that's what everybody wants to hear. Just tell them that. You know, and they'll just follow you and worship you like a goddess. And so we have all these princesses turning into goddesses in the world that want to be expecting to be worshipped. Because they're telling everybody like, well, I don't have any continuity fear. No. Let's spiritualize mortal mind. There's no continuity fear. This is what I like doing. This is what we should be doing. This is what God wants us to do. You know, lies. And people wanting to hear that, you know, being afraid, will then worship them and give them anything they want. Do anything they tell them to do. Absolutely they will. You're already at that point almost. And, you know, most men, if they, you know, they're following a princess, will do anything the princess says, you know, whatever it is. Okay, right away, princess, you know, because you're telling me I don't have a continuity fear. Thank you. You're reinforcing me. I don't have to do anything. Practice. Thank you. You know. That's helping me get with the New World Agenda. Thank you. You know, that's their mindset. This is their mindset. And we think, oh my gosh, I need a goddess to, otherwise how can I get with the New World Order, you know? we're worried about that. How can I survive? Well, we'll let the Holy Spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit is pointing this out to us in such great clarity. Why would it do that if it didn't have something even, you know, totally ready for us to sidestep it? Otherwise, it'd be just sheer maliciousness, wouldn't it? do that, to show clearly it's not the right way, and then it would have no option that it hasn't also can't clearly show us this option and get us into this option, doesn't have this all, you know, that would be maliciousness. It would be totally malicious. So to think that there's no option, you know, would to say is to say the Holy Spirit is completely malicious. You can't say it's incompetent because it's very competently pointed out all this stuff ahead of time. So it's super competent. So if you're super competent and yet refused to, you know, say, wow, you got this terrible problem, but guess what? There's nothing you can do about it. Sorry, I can't help you in any way. This is would be just complete maliciousness. I don't believe the Holy Spirit's malicious. You know, there's no evidence of this. So I refuse to believe that. I don't know exactly what the remedy is. But I feel that the Holy Spirit will, we will become aware of it when the time is right. There's a way to sidestep things. There's a way. I keep in mind the experience I had once where I was being attracted towards spiritualizing mortality in a very strong way, you know, thinking that the goddess, you know, would help me with this. I needed to do that because I didn't know, wasn't sure. I kind of lost faith. And I was standing on the beach, and I was being attracted towards mortality there. And suddenly something said, just move a little bit to your right. So I moved a little bit to my right. Move to your right right now. So I just made this little body movement to my right. And then I felt like a noise and a breeze on my ear. And I said, what the heck? I had no idea what had happened. And I looked around and I was just shocked. I said, something just happened, but I have no idea. It was extraordinary. And I sort of started spiritualizing what had happened and everything. I said, and then I kept looking more at it, and I looked down my feet and I saw this kind of sort of a lump in the sand. There was every sort of something. I said, what is that? What is that? And then I looked and I saw that there was this rock embedded in the sand, had embedded itself in the sand. And that rock was what had gone right past my ear and my head at extreme rate of speed, with so much force, it buried itself in the sand. If I hadn't have made that quick little move to the right at the last second, I mean, literally, it was a split second before that thing whizzed past my head. If I had, it would have completely crushed in my skull. Dead. So, you see, something was watching out after me. And mortal life was setting me up to be killed. There's no question about it. It is quite extraordinary what a killer mentality are pretending to be dead has. It has a very killer mentality. And it sets up quote-unquote accidents. They're not accidents at all. This is something I've realized again and again, that I've been aware of something before it happens. I say, uh-oh, I feel I'm being set up for an accident here. Let me notice something. Oh, this and this, and I'll slow down, something will happen. And then I'll just barely avoid an accident. And then I realize that there were quite a different number of levels to it. And we get set up. We set ourselves up to die, actually. We set ourselves up. That, at least pretending to be mortal mind, does. Whereas the Holy Spirit advises us in advance and says, hey, this is a setup. Be aware of it. Be aware, be aware, be aware. Slow down, slow down. Move a little bit, you know. I got that little sense. I need to move this way a little bit. And prevented, you know, my death, the death of the body. For sure, I wouldn't be here if I hadn't done that. So this little move to the right is what we're doing. A little move to the right, to right-mindedness. Just at the last second, we move to right-mindedness. And we're fine, unscathed. So the Holy Spirit's not malicious. It says you need to make this little move to the right, to right-mindedness. And when you do that, you know, you'll be unscathed by what's to take place. So we're not entirely sure, but don't lose faith just we're not entirely sure. Because right now we're in such a trying to decide, should I go to the right, you know, or stream right? I don't mean politically, but I mean what is right meant, what is true? What is right? What is truth? and that I'm eternal life. I am eternal life. Just be willing to go in that direction, which I'm certainly willing to do this. And it's not a big deal. You won't be frightened by it or anything. You realize, hey, this is what I really want, and I know there's right spiritual practice, and I know I'll be able to do this. Somehow the Holy Spirit will manage it for me, will manage my path for me. And I certainly am not going to put the blinders on. And I'm not going to be reacting. Those who are reacting are afraid that somehow they're going to be forced into it and they're going to fight against it. But the Holy Spirit has a better way. He's saying, you're not even going to be bothered by it at all. They can't even touch you. Won't even be able to touch you. There's no reason to get all upset and call to arms. There's no need for a call to arms. The Holy Spirit has some pathway to safety from this, where we're not even going to be touched by it. But once we realize there is no world, there both is and isn't a world, there can be a bridge to another experiencing easily. It's the Holy Spirit. This is what it sees as needed here. And so it is. So it is. Just like that. And we no longer believe that there's this, you know, quote-unquote world outside of our own desiring it to have this appearance. It's just a pretense. So we can have our pretending, our appearancing to be whatever else we want. We don't have to get rid of a world, but we can have a bridge to some other place easily. Some sort of bridge, absolutely there can be. Without having to attack anything, without having to attack anything, get rid of anything. But again, we don't need to be focused on this too much. It's pragmatic steps right now. Do not react into September. What happens here? Push it into October and say, well, we'll evaluate it then, maybe even later than October. But certainly no sooner than October will we going to give any sort of evaluation on it, because we want to let the smoke clear. We want to see what the Holy Spirit will do before we make any reaction about, am I going to put the blinders on or not? Am I going to resist it or not? We're not even going to take any position on it, which way we're going to go, until we let the Holy Spirit say, well, here's this option. Maybe we'll have the option of right spiritual practice. Maybe we'll have the option of great saviors. You know, so we're going to wait and see, you know, what the overall picture is, what the bigger picture is. We're not going to allow ourselves to be tied down to the pontiff and the POTUS and what they're saying. We're not going to even react at all. We're not even going to evaluate it, really, because we want to see what God's going to do first. And generally speaking, God tends to allow, you know, Holy Spirit tends to allow the ego to have its say, and then the Holy Spirit will have its say. You know, it doesn't want to seem like it's forcing us. You know, we'll feel, because then our continuity fear is such that if the Holy Spirit tried to take the lead, we would panic. We'd panic. We think it's, uh-oh, you know, this is it. So generally, the Holy Spirit allows the ego to take the lead, and then the Holy Spirit will respond to what the ego does, you know, in a very quick, you know, appropriate way. So don't worry. Don't worry about what happens in September. Don't even worry about it. The Holy Spirit will have a very, very great response to it. Very great response to it. Very timely. And don't lose faith at all. Just say, well, we'll see what the Holy Spirit will do. Let the Holy Spirit give the response first before we give any response, before we react in any way. We'll just wait for the Holy Spirit for its response, which will not be reactive, it'll be proactive in some way. Proactive in some way. You see, what I've found is when the Holy Spirit gives us right practice, all the stuff in the world, that we don't have to react to it. We realize, oh, this is totally irrelevant. No need to even think about it. That's how profound it is. Now, you see, most of us are sort of being conflicted a little bit, uncertain, with continuity fear. We still have some. So we'll want to find out what happens 9/11. We'll want to find out what the Pontiff and the POTUS are up to. We'll want to evaluate it, kind of say, okay, do I really want to go in this direction? You know, for me, I don't need to do that. I'm not interested in that. But most people will do that. I hope to have something in October for everyone. I really do. So once you decide, well, maybe, you know, say, no, okay, I've decided I don't want that, then there'll be something, you know, way to go. But for me, I'm dedicated to not even responding to it or thinking about it or talking about it or anything, reacting or anything. I'm full bore on let's find the Saviors. Let's get, you know, the presence of eternal life. Let's have it here. And let's, you know, hit the ground running when people are ready. But I can understand that people might think, some, you know, will say, well, at least I want to hear, kind of know what takes place, and so I can at least evaluate and judge. Well, I've already judged. I already understand the intent and judge the intent and say, you know, so I don't feel I need to do that at all. And is it prejudging prejudice? No, because all that needs to be judged is intent. The specifics don't matter. They will get, the effects will always follow the cause. See, we believe that cause and effect can be separated, so we think that we can't prejudge something until we experience the effects of it. That's nonsense. Cause and effect are not separated, and therefore, if we know the cause, we know what the effects are going to be. You know, we know the feeling of it, the intent, the feeling of it. That's all that we need to know. So the feeling is going to be fear. They're leading us down into delaying and fear. I don't want that. That's not prejudging. That's judging exactly right now, because it can be judged right now. The intent is clear. The effect of this intent will be fear. I don't want to live in fear anymore. So it's not being prejudiced at all. Not in the slightest bit. The ego will say it, because the ego says, well, cause and effect are separate, and you don't know what the effects will be. You know, sure, the intent might be fear, but the effects, could we can spiritualize mortality, it won't be fear, and, you know, we can say, this is a lie. Cause and effect can never be separated. So certainly the ones that say we're being prejudiced is simply a liar and a deceiver, that's all. So I am judging it accurately right now. The Holy Spirit is judging it accurately. The only judgment we need to say is we don't want to keep pretending. We say, I've had enough of that. You know, I can evaporate the continuity fear and be done with it. The sirens, you know, there's a double term for the double meaning for sirens, right? Attracted to the fire. Who is attracted to the being fired up? All the sirens are attracted, right? And when people hear sirens, what do? They follow the sirens to the fire, don't they? Well, of course, there's another term meaning for sirens, and I think it was Greek mythology, are these beautiful females singing, chanting songs, being chantresses, who lead sailors to their destruction upon the rocks, and their death leads them to their death. So people will be following these sirens very soon. These sirens who are leading them to the fire, which is fire of reactivity. You know, and then that goes right into the Pontiff and the POTUS being these heroes, world saviors, who've agreed to put aside their quote-unquote differences. Fact is, they're already on the same page. But they'll say, oh, we're going to make a great sacrifice of our principles for the sake of saving the planet. And so the Pope is going to say all sorts of things. I think the Pope is ready to make all sorts of compromises, so to speak, in principle. Already has, both in word and in deed. He's made it very clear he's willing to do that. if you read what he's been saying, he says, well, I think that, you know, we should consider this, but I'm not really going to do it, but it's, at least we need to dialogue about. He's just getting ready for saying, okay, for the sake of saving the planet, I'm going to say that, you know, Christians have to, Catholics have to make, and Christians in general, well, he's going to try to lump it all together. Is I'll make it a accord with Protestants too. Say, you know what, we're going to drop this and this and this and this, and we're going to have an accord with the Eastern Orthodox Church. We're going to all together drop a lot of this stuff, and we're going to secularize it a lot more. Humanize it a lot more, and the president will say, you know, I'm going to drop, you know, a lot of my, you know, principles about democracy and demanding due process and demanding legislation. I'm going to say, you know what, you know, we're decided we don't, that's going too slow. We're going to just do it by executive order now, and we're going to even decide as a country we're not going to elect a new president at all. That under this extreme crisis, that the whole political process is going to say, look, there's so much conflict in the political process right now. It's going to lead to a civil war. We can't have that. So I'm just going to continue on as president. We're going to suspend, through executive order, just suspend this. And the Pope is going to tell Catholics to go along with this. That this is necessary. So the Catholics are so strong that without the Catholics going along with this, you know, it wouldn't happen. So I think the Pope is somehow going to tell Catholics that, you know, they have to accept this. And because the stake of the survival of the world is at stake. Of course, not all Catholics will accept it, but they'll probably bite their tongue and go along with it. They'll go along with it. So this is at this level, you know, it's at this level right now that we're at. And I know a lot of people will be stunned, but most people will say, hey, this is what we needed. Great. Finally, we have two real leaders here. That's what they'll say. We finally have two real leaders where they're going to go along with it. And, you know, they're using the politics of the United States as an excuse. I mean, this whole Trump thing is an excuse. They'll use it saying, look, I mean, it's looking more and more and more that he would be the next president, and this would be a complete disaster for the world. He doesn't even believe in climate change. We absolutely cannot have that. I guarantee you, they will, you know, they absolutely will not happen. They will not allow anyone who doesn't believe in climate change to be president of the United States. It will not happen. And it seems as though Trump actually has a very good chance, very likely to be the next president if we went through due process of an election. So I don't see how they're going to allow that at all. And I've always believed that this president's the last president. There's not going to be another president of the United States. Same with the Pope. I believe the same thing. And now they have this excuse. They say, we cannot allow, they call it climate change denier. You know, we cannot allow this guy to be president. It would be the ruination of the entire planet. The planet would die. Therefore, it's a small thing to suspend this election. He'll say, well, we'll suspend this election right now for the purpose of restructuring the global governance. And, you know, and we'll see later on if we have an election in some other way. They'll finesse it somehow. They'll finesse it. Now, it may be that there's some asteroid impact that freaks them out even more about the global, you know, climate, etc. But whatever, their goal is the same. It's the same. Is, you know, total world dictatorship. Total loss of freedom. And everybody will embrace it. Almost everybody will say, yeah. I mean, finally. We finally have somebody taking charge here. Good Lord, you know. Of course, they're the ones who caused the problem in the first place. Not that there's any actually a real problem. It's a dream situation. Okay, in a dream situation, you don't have a real problem at all. But it's just another delaying tactic of the ego. Is all it is. Stay super obsessed with fixing the world instead of doing right spiritual practice. Those who are doing right spiritual practice will be seen to be global terrorists because they're climate terrorists, because they're not getting with the agenda of fixing the world. They're just sitting quietly, you know, praying and practicing and affirming. And yes, there is a world and there is not a world. They say, no, you can't see it. There definitely is a world, and it's in, ready to be destroyed. And we're saying there absolutely is a world and absolutely is not a world. The world both is and isn't. There both is a world and isn't a world. And You know, this is what needs to spread throughout the world. This is what would save us from the world, save us from our dreams, save us from our delusion, save us from our fear, you know, save us from our pretension, evaporate the continuity fear. This is what saves, not what they're doing at all. That just binds us to fear. But, you know, for our standpoint, it's good that the veil is being lifted upon their plans. That's very super helpful. Super helpful. And Trump is forcing their hands. This is all prearranged, too. They're all in on it, so to speak. And so they have this excuse now. Because, of course, Trump would never agree with the Pope. He'd tell the Pope where to go. Yeah, whereas the POTUS and the Pope, they're on the same page. Two peas in a pod. Two peas in a pod. So they feel that they have to have this. And Trump now provides the excuse for them to lift the veil and say, look, this is what we got to do, folks. And now, then when this is out in the open, then we can say, hey, Holy Spirit, this is what, you know, this is what the... what they're telling, this is our option here. We don't want this option. What's your option, Holy Spirit? People will then be able to say, hey, Holy Spirit, what's your option? We're willing to listen now. We're willing to listen. So it helps the Holy Spirit out to get this out in the open. And I'm outing the situation right here. I'm outing them, you know, so we can get a head start on this. You know, get going as fast as possible. I've been trying to out this situation for a long time. And, you know, but people are getting there. They're getting there. They're getting there. And so this is just an advanced heads up for everyone. This is what's up. This is what's going on. Of course, they'll finesse it. There's all sorts of spin doctors finessing things, etc. But this is the intent. This is the purpose. This is a level of causative as far as we're talking about. And so we know what the effects ultimately are, being, you know, stuck in fear, blinders, not looking at the continuity fear, refusing the spirit, right spiritual practice, waiting for this scheme we have of trying to be greater than God to be successful, which it never will be. So we just wait in vain, basically waiting in fear in vain, and distracting ourselves as much as possible from this by, you know, trying to monitor everything. And, you know, oh, I got a smartphone, I can send a tweet, or someone can send me a picture. Oh, this is incredible. You know, I'm so awesome. This is just so much awesomeness here. It's just distraction. They're just distraction. It's amazing. I go to this break, there's all these people working. I see these people working. They had their break time, right? And these guys, they're all in the break area. Every single one of them has the smartphone in front of their face and obsessed in it the entire time. The entire time. Nobody says a word to one another. And this is prevalent everywhere, young people. They have their smartphone. Whenever they have a chance, they got the smartphone in front of their face. Whenever they have a chance. This is hideous, 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 hideous egoic activity. Egoic denial, egoic delay. This is why I say the millennials, you know, Jesus said evil and adulterous generation, that before the great tribulation, they're, you know, hooked on the ego, hooked on distraction, hooked on delay, hooked on fear, hooked on waiting. Whereas by not doing that, you know, you're able to turn to the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, how would you like me to use this overall situation right here? Help me practice, help me do deep inquiry. Smartphones connect you to the whole garbage pile of the ego's delaying fear tactics, okay, and propaganda and brainwashing. It connects you to all of that. So you have unlimited, you know, access to it wherever you go. Like, for instance, I do have, on my laptop, I have access to the internet, but I only go to YouTube and occasionally Wikipedia when I'm researching something, and weather. That's it. And occasionally I'll go to sports scores. But other than that, I don't go anywhere. Super rarely I'll open my email, but I don't have any correspondence, so I don't need to. Well, I do post on Twitter and Facebook to let people, and a blog to let people know about this, to get it out. But this is done from YouTube, actually. I do it from YouTube. It allows you to share this automatically. But I don't go anywhere else. So either I'm working to get this information out, or I'm not paying attention to the computer. I do, you know, graphics. I do graphics. So you can say a little bit. Google. I do go to Google, you know, like images if I want Rama Maharshi or something like that. But you can see the basic idea is super, 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 super limited how I use technology. Bare minimum to get the word out. That's it. That's the only right use of it there is, actually. It's bare minimum. Get the word out about right spiritual practice and the option we have to do this. And I can tell you this is a vastly better option because it brings true hope. You gradually realize the fear is dissipating. And what better experiencing could you have right now than to actually realize that your fear is dissipating, that this intense, seemingly impenetrable fear is actually just missed, you know, and you're going through it, you're realizing, oh, there's nothing to it at all. This is just what Jesus tells us. It's just this diaphanous mist, you know. It's not a solid wall at all. Actually, it seems like it is, but it's not. And you're actually going through it, you realize, oh my gosh, bit by bit by bit, you know, it's being dissipated. I realize that it's not stopping me. So this, and then you realize, I'm really going to be free. I'm going to set down this horrible pretense of mortality I've been engaged in, this horrible, fearful situation. What better path could there be than that? There isn't that better one. Trying to spiritualize mortality, that leaves the continuity fear entirely intact. It makes it worse. And so it may seem like for a while that's really a fun path, but then later on, it turns out it's terrible. Whereas the path of evaporating continuity fear with the right spiritual practice, it may start out seeming like it's tough, it's difficult, but it gets better and better and better and better and better. And you realize this is really working. I really am going to be free of this terrible fear, continuity fear. I really am going to abide in the presence of God. I really am going to be a saint. I really am going to have the bliss. There's no doubt about it. And blessed are those who have a tough situation in this world. As I said, I've had a lot of my situation is really very tough in a lot of ways. Very, very nasty. Because that drives you to practicing. It says, wow, I don't want this. I'm going to keep practicing. So if you have a really nasty situation in your life, really, you're really blessed, very blessed. Just use it as an excuse to practice. Use it as an excuse. It's a perfect excuse. Say, wow, this is horrible. Let me practice evaporating my continuity fear so I'm completely free of fear altogether. That's what I want. It's the thorn in the flesh. It's very helpful. It's the thorn that keeps irritating you. Ah, you know, terrible. I want to. How do I get free of this? Okay, so by all means get through to October. By all means get through to October. That's very important. By all means get through to October, and there will be, you know, I would say more help in October by a long shot. October has always been my month of intense spiritual breakthroughs that I've experienced, where you become aware of world saviors in October. I've always experienced this. All the greatest breakthroughs seem to come in October. So, October, I feel, is going to be a very profound, spiritually profound month. We just have to get through September. And again, so then don't react to anything September till October. Don't evaluate it. Don't evaluate it. You know, don't even try to evaluate it. So, well, I'll let, you know, some information come in and before I even think about evaluating it. I did the same thing with 9/11, the first one. I didn't react to pay any attention. I just kept right on with spiritual practice. I did that actually for a long time. I didn't even pay any attention for a long, long time. I said, cause I already knew what it was about. And I said, wait, you know, it's wait until some of the information comes out, and, you know, it's still coming out. And there may be evidence, actually, that may come out. But who's to say? We'll see. But, yeah. To just say, well, I'll evaluate it later. So I didn't watch news, didn't watch anything. I didn't get hooked into the intensity of it at all. Stayed calm. Didn't get hooked into the intensity of it. This is very important. Do not try to evaluate it. So this say, well, I don't want to prejudice my evaluation of the situation until the clear picture, until the dust settles. Otherwise, I feel if I watch the news, I might get really. The spin doctors might spin me into looking only here, and I don't want to really have any. I don't want to let the spin doctors work on my psyche at all. So I'm just going to wait until things die down, until the dust settles, before I even try to wade into it, if at all, if I do at all. I'm not going to wade into it until October. Just have that attitude. Not going to let all the frantic spin doctoring of it. As we know, in 9/11, there's so much frantic spin doctoring. It was very confusing at first, extraordinarily confusing. I'm not going to get pulled into that confusion. I'll let the facts, as the facts get sorted out and things calm down, you know, if I need to, then I'll evaluate it then. But until then, I feel it would be unnecessarily reacting my psyche and confusion, etc. I don't want to subject myself to that. And again, good, bad, and indifferent, because the good might be spun, a lot of spin doctoring on that too, severe spin doctoring. Like I said, this whole thing, the POTIF and the PONTIF, there's going to be massive spin doctoring of that in a positive light, saying, finally, we've made this essential breakthrough in the world. We've been trying to do this for a long, long time. Finally, we have two enlightened leaders who are able to. There may be extreme positive spin doctoring of this, actually, take place. This is what you want to avoid. We might say, well, I want to see maybe that, I feel that there's maybe some other leaders may emerge, and I want to see what they have to say before I really, you know, subject myself to any spin doctoring of this. You know, my feeling is that I want to see it, maybe there's something else also that may be even better, right? Or just, or something that is, a higher wisdom, perhaps, and I just feel I want to see a bigger picture. I want to see that I don't feel like I have the big enough picture, so I don't want to get involved in the spin doctoring of this. So it may be the positive spin doctrine you need to avoid. Like, you know, which I say, well, finally, people will say, finally, we have the great leaders we've been waiting for, God-given leaders. To lead us into the new age, we'll be able to solve our problems. We finally have enough agreement now, and so everybody needs to just absolutely get on board. And I tell you for sure, the sirens will be leading the charge on the news, on the talk shows, etc., etc. Women will be leading this charge, no question about it, and they will be very adamant about it. And appealing with all emotion and tears. They'll be crying, they'll be sobbing. Finally, we you know, the world's going to be saved. We're going to save this beautiful planet. We have the way to do it. And this will like play on everyone's emotions to an extreme extent. And they think, how can I turn down these lovely goddesses who want nothing more than our happiness here in this world? You know, of course, they're Antichrist, 100%. Leading us away from right spiritual practice, realizing there both is and isn't a world, and the bridge to freedom from this pretense altogether. Leading us away from that, they're Antichrist. But they can seem to be very convincing. You know, they'll play on all our reactivity, positive reactivity, you know, sexuality, emotionality, mother worship, you know, glamour, all these various tools that they use. They play on all of that stuff. They'll be, you know, having concerts. I mean, it's going to be a big, big deal probably. I just imagine that the world is, this 9-month period is going to be actually, it will seem to be a very positive thing. Well, the world will finally realize we have a way to survive. Finally, you know, and they finally, we get it. And it'll be a huge celebration, and they'll try to sell, you know, they'll try to sell suspension of elections, they'll try to sell on the Catholicism, changing their principles, they'll try to sell it to everybody. And of course they're going to use all these goddesses to sell it. That's why they're marketing geniuses, that's why they're here in this world. They've been preparing, believe me, they have been preparing. I've been observing their preparation. They have been preparing to take center stage. That's why they're really into music now, singing, even girl groups, you know. They're going to headline the whole thing and saying, guys, you know, this is it. You know, if you don't go along with this, you're never going to even get the time of day from me. And no woman will even give you the time of day, guys, if you don't go for this. You will be persona non grata in this world permanently. And they'll say to the rest of the women, women, sisters, if your man doesn't get with this program, cut him off entirely. Don't even give him the time of day. He's dead to you. He's absolutely dead to you. Grandmothers, aunts, you know, nieces, sisters, spouses, lovers, significant others, everything. If your other does not go along with this, cut them off entirely. Tough love is needed. Now, this is the message that's going to go out. And the girls will absolutely go along with this. They'll do super tough love. They think, you know, it's necessary to save the planet. I say, bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. We're prepared for that. We're aware of it. We're prepared for it. You know, and it's not going to change our awareness in the slightest bit. But it's a good idea to avoid it. You know, and this is what the Holy Spirit is saying, that the tough love that the goddess is going to use in this world most definitely can get to all of us. I'm aware. But see, I'm aware of that too. I'm aware that this can get to us. You know, when all of them in the world decide in one direction, they're going to go this direction, almost all, not all will do this, but the great preponderance will, and they decide to use super tough love, the men are just going to collapse. They're going to crumple. And this is a great problem. Even the saints can crumple. The nearer saints, so to speak, can crumple. So I'm saying, Holy Spirit, protect us from this tough love that is going to be utilized in this world. Absolutely protect us from it. I'm not going to subject myself to it at all. I don't want to be subjected to it at all. Yeah, don't want to be subjected to it at all. It's not just like playing tough, hard to get. You know, this is another strategy. Some of the guys are saying, oh, if I just play hard to get, then maybe I can, you know, get a lot of action, a lot of love from the women, which may be true, but maybe not too. But don't even play hard to get. Just saying, absolutely not. You know, stone cold failure for you. Up front. You have no chance, zero chance here. And I'm not even going to give you an opportunity to even try. That's how set I am. You're not even going to get an opportunity to even try. This is my viewpoint. No even opportunity to even try is the best way to go about this right now. Since we know what the whole thing is basically set up as, let's not even give them an opportunity to even try to change our minds. Now, I know I don't want my mind changed. I know it's set on eternal life. I know what they're trying to do is get it set on mortal falsity, mortal mind. So, I in no way should I give them a chance to try and pull me into what I don't want to go into. Why should I even give them a chance? That's ridiculous. For what? So my position is I don't want to even have them, let them have an opportunity at all. It's a lose-lose. So yeah, no opportunity. Don't even give them a chance. Fabulous. So we're getting, see, this is our brand of tough love. This is our brand of tough love. See, we know what's right, and so we're using tough love in that direction. That you're not going to have any chance to pull those who know truth down into deception. So they'll be available to help those who want to go in the right direction to help them practice. See, no chance for that. No opportunity. That's our tough love. That's Holy Spirit's tough love. So, Holy Spirit, let your tough love prevail in my life and the life of all those who know that you are telling us the truth and guiding us to what we really want. All right, very great. This is getting very, very intense and interesting. Wonderful. Enjoyable, very enjoyable, all this. You know. Hey, I just discovered, you know, bring your tough love, Holy Spirit. Pray for the Holy Spirit's tough love here. No chance, and even no opportunity. Which is it's all about sidestepping it. Don't get in arguments with them. Don't get in arguments with the sirens. The tough love sirens saying, well, hey, you know, I'm right and to do this tough love. And, you know, don't even get in an argument with them because they're all in. So, you know, sidestep it. Sidestep it somehow. The Holy Spirit, I don't know how it will do this, but it will do it somehow. And not by going into some coma. No, you got to be better than that, Holy Spirit. It's not like I'm going to a coma for the next, you know, 9 months. No, I don't want that. We've got to be, you know, it's got to be consciously, you know, sidestepping it consciously here. So don't anyone go into a coma. We can do better than that. Holy Spirit can do better than that. So we're getting a very, very nice picture here of the future and being aware of it, you know, ahead of time, wisely aware of it ahead of time. Now, will those who we sidestep be confused? Sure. But that confusion will lead to the Holy Spirit because they'll say, wait, how is this possible? It's not possible. this is crazy. How could this happen? You know, we weren't told that this could happen. I can't account for it in any way. Except they're evil, they're terrible, but they still got to escape, you know, and I should have power over that. What happened? My power didn't work. My magic didn't work. You know, this will work on them. Of course it will cause them consternation, but then it'll lead to the Holy Spirit, because they'll say, you know, does anyone know what happened? And the Holy Spirit will say, yeah, I know exactly what happened. And they'll realize, oh, someone knows what happened. I want to find out about this. And they'll be led on the path that way. So it's all good. It's win-win. So, sidestepping time. Don't get into any arguments with anyone. Don't get into any arguments with anyone. That is very important. The ego will try to pick an argument with you right now. This is what I'm aware of. In any way that it can, it will try to pick an argument with you. And those are working for the goddess. Those who are trying to pick an argument with you are working for the goddess right now. The tough love. They're part of the tough love plan of the goddess, of the ego in this world. And they'll try to pick an argument. Don't get into any arguments with anybody for any reason. Just be quiet. Just say, no, I'm not, you know, just maybe later. You know, not right now, not in September. No arguments in September. I'm not going to get into any arguments in September. Very important. Very important. And they can be very clever about picking arguments. Very clever. It can be very spiritual, you know, spiritual argument, very some spiritual way. Now, no arguments now, under any circumstances. No matter how clever it may seem, you say, you know, I'm committed, Holy Spirit, committed to no arguments in September. We'll see how we feel in October about it all. And of course, they're desperate to get you into an argument right now. Because when you start getting into argument, you start getting engaged, you see, and they feel that they'll win. They'll be able to pull you through with their glamour and all their tricks. They'll be able to actually, you know, reel you in. It's like hooking a fish and reeling it in. So don't take the bait of the argument. The argument, the bait is this juicy argument they're tossing out, like, hey, you know, let me get an argument about this. If we disagree, let me argue about it. Don't take the bait. Don't take the bait at all. Everyone that has, I say, You're perfectly free to get off. Slip the hook. So just slip the hook, that's all. Say, well, not in September. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm not going to argue in September. Maybe October, we'll see how we feel. We'll see how I feel in October. We'll go from there. We'll pick it up from there and see, reevaluate it then. But right now, no arguments. Like climate change. Someone says, well, do you believe in it? They try to get you. I'm not evaluating or judging anything in September. I will, any position that I have, I'll state it in October, if at all. We'll see how things shake out in October. I just feel September is kind of like a jubilee month for me. Let it be a spiritual jubilee month for you, where you take a break from evaluating and judging and all this, and you say, let's see how things stand in October. Let it be a jubilee sidestepping month, September. A jubilee sidestepping month for you. Sidestepping all arguments, all controversies, all of that. And placing basic faith in the Holy Spirit and in the wisdom of the Holy Spirit suggesting this. So so I'm not going to support or defend any position. You know, we can still go on with our spiritual practice, of course, but we're not going to be supportive or defensive of it during September. We say, well, I both believe in this and don't believe in this. Or, you know, I both agree or don't agree. But we're just going to take a jubilee in terms of positioning, any publicly, probably position ourselves publicly. Take a one-month jubilee on this. Do not allow yourself to get pinned down. And then we will see what our options are in October. Okay. Very great. Let this just sink in, and we will go forward very rapidly. This is a tremendous jump forward right here. But don't get in arguments about it. Just, you know, keep it to yourself and let the wow come in, and this will help wake you up, and you start waking up. But just be disciplined. Don't get into arguments, positional arguments, in September. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.